Ghil'ad Zuckermann is an expert in language revival and linguistics with 30-odd years of experience. Professor Zuckermann was featured in episode 3 of Who We Are on the topic of Indigenous language revival. Here is the extended version of his interview. So just to start off with, I know that you've had such a varied career and it might be hard to sort of pinpoint just one aspect of it, but can you tell me a bit about your research on language reclamation and perhaps some of the work that you've done when it comes to Indigenous languages?
Absolutely. So when I arrived in Australia in 2004, it was in Melbourne at the time, I asked myself, how can I give back to the hosting community? And I discovered two main problems in Australia. That was 20 years ago. The first was a bureaucratic mindset. And I said, how can I solve that? I cannot. So I will just swallow the bitter pill. And what's the other problem? It was the Aboriginal plight, the fact that Aboriginal people who had been here for at least 51,000 years lost their land, lost their intellectual sovereignty, lost their cultural autonomy, their spirituality, their languages, etc. And then I said, okay, I'm not a dentist, I cannot give teeth, I'm not a psychologist, I cannot get my Aboriginal friends out of, smoking. So I'm a linguist. And at the time, I was an expert of the Hebrew language revival. So I am a speaker, a native speaker of what I call Israeli, which is the result of the revival of Hebrew after 1,750 years, when Hebrew was a sleeping beauty. And I said, oh, there were 400 Aboriginal languages in Australia, and at the time, only 12 were alive and kicking. So in other words, 97% of languages in Australia had been killed. So then I said in 2004, that was 20 years ago, to dedicate my time in Australia to language revival. And I decided to do it on three levels. The first one was macro, then micro, and then the mucro. So the macro was to establish a new transdisciplinary field of inquiry that I call revivalistics. And in fact, I published a book recently during COVID about revivalistics, which is attacking language revival from any angle, not only from the linguistic side, but also from the sociological, legal, mental health, dance, architecture, etc. So it's a completely transdisciplinary field of inquiry. So that was in the macro. In the micro, I decided to look for a specific Aboriginal tribe whose language had been killed and who is interested in reclaiming it. And this is eventually when I discovered the Bangala Aboriginal community. And in 2011, I asked five Bangala leaders to come to my office at the University of Adelaide. And I told them I discovered a dictionary from 1844 written by a German Lutheran missionary called Klammerheim Schumann. And I told them that I know that your language had been killed 50 years ago, and if you're interested, we can reclaim it. And they told me, we've been waiting for you for 50 years. So that was the beginning of the Bangala language reclamation. I've been doing this for 12 years, and it is now in the transition period when I pass the baton to the community. So I see myself as a facilitator. Of course, the ones at the wheel are the custodians, the language owners. So I have more and more teachers who are Bangala, who know how to teach the language, etc. And now we are getting it into the schools and kindergartens in Port Lincoln, Wayala, Port Augusta. So this is a success story. And then the third thing that I decided to do in 2004 was in the MOOC. So MOOC is a massive open online course, and I eventually devised a course like that, and I have had 20,000 students from all over the world, 190 countries. So this is why I'm currently in Bangkok, because the Thai people contacted me following this course. This course was made it in 2013-14. So now I go to Namibia, to New Caledonia, to, of course, New Zealand, to Tibet, to Mongolia, and all these people, they saw how we do language reclamation in Australia, and they want to get some insights into their own revival. So practically my vision was to turn Australia from the world's leader in linguicide, language killing, to the world's leader in revivalistics, language revival. And I'm happy to say that it is happening. And it's nice to see that when I started, you know, you could count the tribes in Australia that conducted language revival, whereas now it's like everybody is applying for funds, and so it's becoming much more common and much more kind of much less far from the mainstream.
You mentioned that Japanese phrase of ikigai and the way you describe these things and their interconnectedness. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think from a Western perspective, we don't always hear about the interconnectedness of things in that same way. But you mentioned the benefits of language and reviving those languages. Can you expand on the mental health benefits of language revival? And where do you see this area going in the future?
Eventually, I believe that many linguistics departments will be kind of replaced by revivalistics departments, because language revival has to do not only with the arts, but also with health. And what my research discovered is that it's not only ethically the right thing to do to reclaim languages that had been killed by colonization, by stolen generations. It's not only the aesthetic thing to do. You know, it's beautiful to have a diversity in the world with many people speaking different languages. Social cohesion is not from the monolingual mindset. I mean, this is kind of a fallacy of many modern people. They say, oh, everybody will speak the same language and then we will have no wars. These people forgot to Google Rwanda 1994 or Syria 2019. I mean, people spoke the very same dialect and killed each other. So what I'm saying is that there is the ethical, the aesthetic reason, but most importantly, from the perspective of the public servant, the utilitarian reason. So I've noticed the more I revive languages, that people showed feelings of empowerment, of you know, improving their mental health. I have many people that I can introduce you to who, you know, try to commit suicide and then through the discovery of their heritage language stopped being suicidal. And in fact, there was a research in Canada in 2007 that proved that there was a correlation between language loss and youth suicide. This was in British Columbia. But what I discovered is that there is also a correlation between language revival and the diminishing of suicidal ideation. In other words, it does not only go one way. You kill a language, you cause suicide, but also it goes the other way. You revive a language, and then you improve the well-being, the mental health. So I started because of the ethical reasons. So that's the right thing to do. I mean, these languages deserve to be revived, but I ended up staying in the field because of the utilitarian benefits. I mean, you know, this is how you can help people. So I personally believe that language revival should be under the Faculty of Health, not the Faculty of Arts, because, as you know, I mean, in Australia especially, the arts are in a very bad situation. I mean, fewer and fewer professors in the arts, etc. Whereas in health, I mean, we saw it during the pandemic. The amount of money which is spent on health is huge. So if I manage to prove scientifically that language revival improves health, if I manage to prove that if I reclaim a language, there would be fewer cases of diabetes, which I completely believe, because it's a gestaltic way of looking at the world, a holistic way. Aboriginal people are very much like Asians in their medicine, you know. So I remember going in China to a first time many years ago, and to a doctor and I said that I have a headache, and he told me, can I touch your toes? And I said, no, it's a headache, you know. So then I learned about this gestaltic idea and a holistic idea. Aboriginal people are the same thing. So you revive a language, you improve the intellectual sovereignty, the cultural autonomy, the spirituality, you bring back soul, metaphorically speaking. Therefore, the Aboriginal person feels better about himself. He or she eats less kind of shitty food. They're less obese. They have less sugar in the blood, and therefore they have less diabetes. So it's kind of a domino effect. It's not just that you come to my reclamation workshop. I've conducted hundreds, and then the next, you don't have dialysis. I'm not talking about that. So practically, I found an ikigai. You know, ikigai is the interface, the intersection between what you love, what you're good at, what the world needs, and what you're paid for. I feel more and more that, you know, in the arts, in the humanities, the ikigai is being kind of damaged by decisions of, you know, governments, etc. But by and large, it's a very good ikigai. So this is what I do. I revive languages in Australia, but also all over the world.
Yeah, going back to that point that you mentioned about how you found the dictionary and that being a starting point for the Bangala language revival, I wanted to ask you about the process of reviving a language. What does that look like? Does it look different depending on the scenario, or does it start with something like the dictionary that you found? And can I also ask you, how did you find the dictionary?
Any language revival in the world, in my view, must consist of four components. The four components are the custodians. So I do not believe in a laboratorial language revival. So, I mean, you know, some kind of, you know, like geeks, they say, okay, well, why don't we revive Latin? So what do you mean? I mean, Latin is alive and kicking in the form of Italian, Catalan, Spanish, French, etc. There is no community that is called Latin community that would like to reclaim its lost language. I only revive languages with custodians, with language owners. So the first component, it's a necessary component, of course it's not sufficient, unfortunately, is the language owners. So you must have language owners. The second component is a public sphere. You must have support from the government. You must, for example, it would be very helpful if the Australian government decided to have 401 official languages in Australia, namely 400 Aboriginal and one the sign language of the deaf people. Because in Aotearoa, New Zealand, you have two languages that are official. One is Te Reo Māori, the language Māori, and the other one is not English, surprise, but it's the New Zealand sign language. English is de facto, but it's not de jure. Now, so the public sphere means also not only officialdom, but also when you go to Galinyala, you will have signs in Bangala as well, so not just in English. We are actually changing it. So if I take you to Galinyala, which is Port Lincoln, you'll be able to see for the first time in history that there is a sign saying Galinyala. Now, until 1 year ago, nobody knew that the Bangala word for Port Lincoln was Galinyala. This is our work. So we convinced the authorities, I mean, in this case, the council, etc., to change. So this is the public sphere. The third component, linguistics. You need resources and you need linguistics. You need a grammar, so you need a linguist to analyze the resources and to make sure that there is a grammar available. And this is exactly what I did when I discovered the manuscript written by the German guy, Klammer Wilhelm Schumann, who wrote it in order to Christianize the heathens in quotation marks. So he did it, in my view, for his own selfish / brainwashed / egotistic / solipsistic idea that, you know, he has seen the light. And therefore, he wants everybody else to see the same light. Now, you might say he had very good intentions. I'm sure he had good intentions. Klammer Wilhelm Bühlmann, who was a Lutheran missionary, his intentions were very good. He saw the light. He thought that Jesus Christ was the epitome of good, etc. So why not go and find heathens, in quotation marks, all over the world and show them the light? Now, as a secular Jew, of course, it's kind of laughable from my own perspective, but I'm sure he had good intentions. So he wrote this dictionary in 1844 to Christianize. We use this very dictionary to aboriginalize. Now, this is topsy-turvy, because, and how do we do it? Because the dictionary, which includes 3,500 words, which is many words, I mean, let us not forget the Old Testament has 8,000 words, 2,000 of them hapax legomena, which means only appearing once, so only 6,000 words practically, because a word that appears once, you never know what exactly it means. So 6,000 words in the Old Testament. Some regard the Old Testament as the epitome of beauty, etc. And Bangla has 3,500, so it's almost the same. We have the grammar. I discovered it in the library in the archives in Adelaide. So I had the basis to write an entire grammar and an entire dictionary. So that's wonderful. So that's linguistics. And the fourth component is pedagogy. So it's not enough to be a linguist. I mean, most linguists I know are helpless, hopeless teachers. They don't know how to teach. You need also to be very savvy pedagogically. You need to know how to teach a language. Not every linguist is a language teacher. Not every teacher is linguistically savvy. So you need to combine these four components. Now, if I invited, when I invited the Bangla people in November 2011, and they told me, look, yeah, you're right, we lost our language, but, you know, we don't want to bother about it, you know, like, too complicated, and etc. I would have never embarked upon the Bangla language reclamation. So it was a necessary condition to have the custodians on board, because it's, as I said earlier, it's not laboratorial, you know. Some linguists don't understand it. And this is why revivalistics is not linguistics. It's far greater, far more advanced when it comes to speakers rather than language, than linguistics. I mean, linguistics puts the language at the center. Revivalistics puts the language owner at the center. So if, for example, I go to an Aboriginal community and I tell them, look, in your language 200 years ago, the seat of emotions was the belly, the stomach. So if the stomach is happy, then it means you're happy. And then they tell me, no, look, we are Aboriginal. We feel that the seat of emotions is the heart. Now, of course, as a revivalist who is also a linguist, I know that they got the heart from the colonizers' language, namely English. Because in English, you're heartbroken. In Bangla, you're stomach broken. But if they tell me, look, we know better than you, we feel, I know that they do not know better than me the original language, because the language had been a Sleeping Beauty. But it is their decision, eventually. The revivalist could inspire, the revivalist could give information, but the revivalist would never decide for them. Now, a linguist would say, look, I don't care about what you say. This is the seat of emotions according to the language, and that's it. Whereas a revivalist must be much more attuned to the community. A revivalist has to have a heart of gold, you know, balls of steel. I mean, metaphorically speaking, of course, many women are revivalists. The willingness to, or the agreement to act as a punching bag, because you're dealing with disadvantaged, unprivileged people. So, of course, there'll be some aggression, some violence. That's part and parcel of the endeavor to reclaim a language. This kind of area is extremely complex historically. There was a lot of ransacking by linguists in the past. And therefore, and one of the reasons I thought I should establish a new field of inquiry was that. So revivalistics is not linguistics. It includes, some of it has linguistics, but it's much more than that. How do you revive a language? Coming back to your question, the moment you have the desire of the community, and the moment you have the resources needed, and the moment you have the public support or part of public support, in the case of Bangla, at the beginning it was my own donation. So, I mean, when it comes to food and, you know, transport of Aboriginal people, so it was my own kind of donation. But then eventually we managed to get some support from the government as well. So, and then, of course, you have pedagogical tools that you create. Then you go to the bush and you conduct reclamation workshops. I've conducted hundreds. And a reclamation workshop is in the form of, say, 3 days of learning the language, children, old people, everybody together, singing in language, neologizing, making, you know, coining new words in language, which now we do not do much because they prefer everybody to learn all the words that are pre-existent. But we used to do it. So we used to, for example, coin a word for computer. There was no computer in 1844, needless to say. But we decided to go for Gaga Bibi Wari Birga. Gaga means head. Bibi means egg. So the egg inside the head is the brain. So Gaga Bibi is brain in Bangla. And Wari Birga in Bangla means lightning. So Gaga Bibi Wari Birga is a lightning or electric brain. So with this regard, it's kind of similar to Chinese. In Chinese, a dian nao means electricity or lightning brain. And this is the word for computer. So Gaga Bibi Wari Birga is too long. So then we decided together to shorten it to Gabiwa. So Gaga Bibi Wari Birga is Gabiwa. Gabiwa. So the word for computer in Bangla is Gabiwa. And then, you know, when I teach Bangla in the reclamation workshops, I have to teach all the pronouns. There are many, many pronouns. Say, if I and you, you and I, if we are, you are related to me through a woman. So, for example, you are my sister's daughter. So let's say you're my sister's daughter. Then we two, which is a pronoun, it would be Nadlaga. But if you are my brother's daughter, we two would be Marini. So the pronoun depends on the kinship between you and me, whether it's matrilineal or whether it's patrilineal. The pronoun would be different. Now, this is fascinating and complex compared to English, where you do not even have we two. You just say we. So we is a pronoun for any more than one. You say we, whereas in Bangla, plural is different from we too, but then if you're related to each other through a mother, a woman, it would be different from if you're related to each other through a man. So we learn all these pronouns and then we decide, oh, wow, I mean, can we actually act according to that or is it too complex? I mean, because you cannot, you know, when you revive a language, of course, the emerging tongue would never be the same as the language used to be. It's impossible. I mean, maybe one day ChatGPT will take us to new realms, but currently it's impossible. So Israeli, my mother tongue, is very different from the Hebrew of the past. Extremely different. I mean, I could talk to you at length only about the differences between Hebrew and Israeli, but there is no problem whatsoever with that because the emerging tongue is kind of a new diversity, and I have no problem with lack of authenticity. When an Aboriginal person tells her daughter, give us authenticity or give us death, she will get the death. In fact, it happened in Tiwi, on Tiwi Island, which is north of Darwin, when the Aboriginal elders told their children, give us authenticity or give us death, because the children did not speak the language as the elders spoke. But the result was that the children resorted to English. So they received death, which is, in my view, very tragic because, in fact, I prefer a hybrid language to a non-language. So I prefer, you know, I prefer Neo-Bangla to English, you know. So, look, it's a very complex, I mean, language revival, I mean, in my view, every language of the world that needs a revival, so we have 7,000 languages in the world, within 100 years we'll end up with 700, so 90% of languages would disappear. So 6,300 languages, in my view, should have each of them one revivalist in charge. This is not the situation currently. And then we have 400 languages. We have only 12 are alive and kicking. So 388 languages should have one linguist revivalist in charge. That's not the situation right now. So I'm the linguist of Bangla, of Bayungu, but you do not have one person per language, you know, absolutely not. So, look, if there is something which could be practical out of the podcast that you're talking about, it would be kind of inspiring young Aussies who are linguistically savvy to realize that there is a future out there for them to help people. Sometimes it's 2,000 people, 2,500, but that's wonderful. You know, if you save one soul, it's like you save the entire world, as they say in the Jewish scriptures.
That was Ghil'ad Zuckermann, an expert in language revival and linguistics at the University of Adelaide. If you'd like to hear more, check out the SBS News series, Who We Are, wherever you get your podcasts.